watching Tag TV.
Hello viewers, welcome to Newsweek South Asia, a program that talks about breeding of terrorism and its impact on South Asian nations. Let's begin with the headlines first. Indian security forces foil infiltration bid in Kashmir. Pakistan's military men boosting ties with jihadi groups. And Taliban denies agreeing to ceasefire settlement in Afghanistan. Since the abrogation of Article 370 in the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir, rattled Pakistan has stepped up efforts to infiltrate terrorists into the Indian Territory. However, the Indian security forces, despite suffering losses, managed to foil all its devious agendas. Recently, Indian Army foiled an infiltration bid by the ultras on New Year's Day as they battled heavily armed terrorists along the line of control in Jammu and Kashmir's Rajouri district. Two Indian soldiers were also martyred in this counter-terrorism operation. A report.
In a bid to create unrest in the Kashmir Valley, Pakistan is consistently making efforts to infiltrate terrorists into the Indian Territory. Recently, Indian Army foiled a major infiltration bid of Pakistan-backed terrorists in India's northern Rajouri district of Jammu and Kashmir. The infiltrators were intercepted in Khari Thrayath forest in the wee hours when they were trying to sneak into India from Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. According to official inputs, Army had launched a search and cordon operation following the information about movement of suspected terrorists, during which militants opened fire, leading to a gun battle which claimed the lives of two Indian soldiers.
There was a cordon and search operation wherein we lost two of our boys. I'm sure our boys will avenge this. Our boys will avenge this because that those days, as the new chief has very rightly said, that Pakistan will have to pay a price. And we reserve the right to hit back, not just in our own area, but in the areas from where these terrorist activities are being launched, originating. So to that extent, India has come a long way. We are not reactive and simply defensive, purely defensive and reactive and confined to consequence management. The Indian Army will now, the Indian Armed Forces will now hit across the border at the source of the problem and not just manage the consequences in our own territory.
Terrorism has always been used as proxy by Pakistan to wage a war against India, and it has intensified its operations ever since New Delhi revoked the special status of Jammu and Kashmir, bifurcating it into two union territories. Pakistan has been hiring mercenaries and sending them across the border to spread unrest. However, vigilant Indian forces have thwarted almost all of its designs in past few weeks. A significant number of infiltrators have been eliminated, while many others have been apprehended. Newly appointed Chief of Indian Army Staff, Manoj Mukund Narvane, warned Pakistan of refraining from any misadventure. He also said Pakistan had been exposed globally for its role in promoting terrorism.
They're trying to use terrorism as a tool of state policy, as a way of carrying out a proxy war against us while maintaining deniability. However, this state cannot last long. As they say, you cannot fool all the people all the time. So they may try this, but they will not succeed. And as far as the situation on the LC is concerned, it is what it was in the recent past. There are ceasefire violations. We are aware that there are terrorists on the other side in various launch pads waiting to cross over. But we are fully prepared to meet this threat. We have a strong counter-insurgency and counter-terrorist grid, which we keep modifying as per the inputs that we receive, and we are fully prepared to tackle any eventuality.
Pakistan feels cornered after its erstwhile ally United States put a full stop on the aid it would provide to counter terrorism. it stands on the verge of being declared a terrorist nation. Pakistan Army generals who are at the helm of forming policies against India must realize at this point that all their strategies have proven to be counterproductive. It is in their interest if they stop hatching anti-India plots and focus on the welfare of their own people.
Consistent humiliating defeats at the hands of Indian Army has baffled Pakistan's army so badly that its high-ranking officers are now openly engaged in boosting relations with terror groups. Pakistan's Director General of Inter-Services Public Relations, Major General Asif Ghafoor, recently visited Jamia Rashidiya Mosque, which share links with Jaish-e-Mohammed, the terror group responsible for 2019 Pulwama terror attack. The mosque also has connections with several other terrorists and terror groups functioning in the country.
Top Pakistani army and security officers are busy elevating ties with representatives of jihadi groups. Pictures and videos of growing public contact between the terrorist and the security agencies are doing rounds on social media since the day Pakistan's General Director of ISPR, Major General Asif Ghafoor, visited the infamous and hardline Jamia Rashidiya Madrasa or mosque in Karachi. The latest visit suggests that Pakistani military establishment is not at all serious about severing its ties with such organizations. Major General Asif Ghafoor, the Director General of the military's media arm, visited the hardline Jamia Rashidiya Seminary while on a trip to Karachi with the Army Chief, General Kamar Bajwa.
The tie-up of the ISI with Jaish-e-Mohammed group, well, it's been there for a long time. This is nothing new, really. So if you say that this is an indicator that the general goes and meets somebody from Jaish-e-Mohammed in a particular mosque which is influenced by Jaish-e-Mohammed or which is possibly being run by Jaish-e-Mohammed, firstly, such mosques are many in Pakistan. It's not one or two or three. There are plenty of such mosques in Pakistan. And these meetings between them are not uncommon. This is something which goes to further convince people, and especially the FATF, hopefully, that the linkages between the Pakistani terrorist groups and the ISI and per se the Pakistani army in the bargain, there is no dilution in that.
Pak Fauj Zindabad! Pak Fauj Zindabad!
Images and videos of the visit show General Ghafoor being fitted like a rock star while addressing the Heartland Madrasa students. For most terror watchers, Jamia Rashidiya is best known for its links to Jaish-e-Mohammed and the 2002 murder of Wall Street Journal reporter Daniel Pearl. Pakistani Army's gaping friendship with terror outfits suggests outlining of a prospective terror plan against India between the two. In view of the growing proximity among Pakistani Army and terrorists, Indian security agencies have been kept on alert in all border areas to avert any unlikely situation programmed by Pakistan in India.
A single meeting between the general and Jaish-e-Mohammed leadership or Jaish-e-Mohammed second rung leaders, whoever they met in that particular mosque in Karachi, is surely not an indicator, because such meetings are not uncommon, not definitely uncommon. This is perhaps to strategize. In any case, they have, I'm sure, certain contingencies worked out about what attacks to be carried out against India, where to be carried out, etc. And these contingencies, once they really decide to execute an attack, these contingencies will be rehearsed, and that's how an attack will start progressing.
In recent years, the Pakistani military had started to distance itself from jihadist groups and leaders, largely due to pressure from the Western capitals, Financial Action Task Force or FATF, and India. Major General Asif Ghafoor's visit to the Jaish-e-Mohammed Madrasa could pave way for grave trouble for Pakistan, which is due to face next round of proceedings in FATF in February 2020, where it is most likely to get blacklisted for failing to put curbs on terror funding and running schools and madrasas linked to proscribed terror entities.
since the US invasion in Afghanistan that toppled the regime of Taliban in October 2001, the Islamic group regained the strength as an insurgency and continues to control a large number of its territories, unleashing violence and bloodshed in the war-torn nation. Recently, Taliban insurgents unleashed a fresh wave of violence, killing more than 40 Afghan forces at four different provinces of Afghanistan. Besides, the Taliban denied agreeing to any ceasefire in Afghanistan after rumors swelled of a potential deal that would see a reduction in fighting after more than 18 years of war. A report.
The war-ravaged nation of Afghanistan continues to remain tense as security checkpoints in Afghanistan are constantly being targeted by Taliban insurgents. Recently, a series of multiple attacks by Taliban insurgents against military checkpoints in northern Afghanistan claimed lives of more than 40 Afghan soldiers. On 29 December 2019, a Taliban attack killed 17 local militia men in a pro-government militia compound of northern Takhar province. A similar militia compound was targeted in Jozjan province, killing 14 members of the Afghan security forces. In the third attack, at least 10 Afghan forces were killed and 4 others were wounded on a police checkpoint in Kunduz province of northern Afghanistan. And similarly, 8 policemen were killed and 3 injured at a checkpoint in the northern Afghan province of Balkh by Taliban insurgent groups on January 1. Intensifying its blood game, Taliban staged almost daily attacks in Afghanistan's northern and northeastern province over the past week. These relentless attacks highlight Taliban's strengthened position in this 18-year-old battle.
They have increased their footprints. The level of violence has gone up. The incident of terrorism has gone up. They are controlling almost 60% of the territory right now. And if you go through, they have shown resurgence in various factors. If you see the drug trade, they are controlling the entire belt, which is famous for drugs. And if you go through the United States report itself, there seems that the drug production in that area, which is controlled by the Taliban, has increased multifold, because that money is being used to sponsor, aid narco-terrorism.
The horrific cycle of war and violence does not appear to end anytime soon in Afghanistan. In its latest official stand, the Taliban denied agreeing to any kind of temporary ceasefire. The denial came after the United States demanded the Taliban to commit to a temporary ceasefire before the peace process could be resumed and a deal signed between them. The spokesperson of the Taliban in Afghanistan, Zabula Mujahid, officially said that discussions are still underway about reduction of violence and lessened operations, but there are no ceasefire plans. The latest withdrawal in dialogue comes after multiple media reports suggested the insurgent group was on the verge of announcing a temporary truce.
This renewed effort, this renewed hope, may not yield more in terms of having peace talks unless and until Taliban has a control over the government, or they want to be part of the government.
The United States, which is backing the Afghan government in the battle, has been trying to negotiate with Taliban from a long time, but the dialogue process has suffered setbacks due to constant violence. In September, the US and the Taliban had appeared on the verge of signing a deal aimed at reducing America's military footprint in the country. But later, Trump abruptly broke off the diplomatic engagement with the Taliban after a particularly deadly spate of violence broke out in Kabul, in which 12 people were killed, including a US soldier. The talks remained halted for over 2 months until the US president, in a recent surprise visit to Afghanistan, informed about the resumed peace talks between the concerned parties. Later, US Special Envoy Zalmay Khalilzad also arrived in Kabul on December 4th in a bid to breathe new life into efforts to end the war in Afghanistan. But the resumed talks seems to have a short life, Since following a suicide attack on a U.S. base outside Kabul, Zalmay Khalilzad announced about a brief pause from talks between the Taliban and the U.S. negotiators.
Year 2019 witnessed some of the worst terrorist attacks in South Asia. Beginning with deadly Pulwama attack in February 2019, radical Islamic terrorists launched the decade's worst serial terror attack in the island nation Sri Lanka on Easter Sunday in April. Insurgency also continued in Afghanistan as the country witnessed a string of violent attacks sponsored by Pakistan, the deadliest among them being the wedding blast in August 2019, that claimed over 90 lives. Here is a report.
South Asia has for long been facing the wrath of Islamist terrorism. According to a partial data compiled by an online terrorism portal since 2005, the region has accounted for at least 71,400 Islamist terrorism-linked fatalities. Year 2019 saw three deadliest attacks in South Asia, which together claimed 391 lives.
South Asia has been facing a lot of militant attacks, mainly sponsored by the ISI. And Pakistan is using ISI and ISI is using the militants to sponsor and to forward its own policy to ensure that people come in line, the countries that are in the neighborhood come in line and support Pakistan. Now, in Sri Lanka, the Easter Sunday attack was an eye-opener for them, and the crackdown that was done came out with startling results. There were big businessmen who were involved, and it was the same on the same pattern as what happened in India in the Bombay blast, when Dawood Ibrahim and his family were involved in it. This shows that Pakistan has not given up its policy of using terrorism as its state policy and furthering its interests.
As the world was still celebrating the fervor of New Year, India received a major setback in the form of Pulwama terror blast on February 14th. On that day, the beautiful land of Kashmir Valley was soaked with the blood of brave martyrs of Indian CRPF when a convoy of around 2,500 Central Reserve Police Force personnel was targeted by a Jaish-e-Muhammad suicide bomber, Adil Ahmed Dar. The attack on Indian security forces was the result of Pakistan's desperate pressure on the terrorists to indulge into action in Kashmir. Pulwama terrorist attack shares direct links with Pakistan's notorious spy agency, Inter-Services Intelligence, or ISI, because an extensive, properly planned terror attack could not have been possible without a high-profile external support. Masood Azhar, the main conspirator of the Pulwama attack, has still not been brought to justice owing to ISI's support to these terror lords.
Justice system all over the world requires evidence to convict anyone. Masood Azhar is the child and baby of ISI and the Pakistan Army, and they ensure that no evidence is presented against him whenever his case is called up in the court. It is for this reason that judges find it very difficult to give him a conviction.
As many as 253 people died while hundreds got injured in a series of bomb blasts that hit luxury hotels and churches across Sri Lanka on Easter Sunday, leaving the entire country in a state of shock and lockdown. The attacks were claimed by the Islamic State, which is seeking to revive itself in South Asia after getting ousted from Iraq and Syria. It is pertinent to mention here that no terrorism group operates in a vacuum, and each has some type of sponsor to help them stay funded and operational. In South Asia, Inter-Services Intelligence, or Pakistan's ISI, is the main organization that provides aids to the terror groups. The intensity of the Sri Lanka serial blast left the South Asian region aghast, which was already struggling to overcome the shock of Pulwama blast. This time, the target was different, but again, the perpetrator was same, that is Pakistan.
Pakistan and ISI's footprint on the Easter Sunday attacks is very clear. The ISI was the main perpetrator which organized the shifting of the arms, ammunition, stocking and piling of it, plus training these people who later on went up to put on the explosives in all the churches. The ISI footprint was again very visible the way after this attacks, these people who were involved in it were excavated, evacuated from Sri Lanka and brought to Pakistan.
Afghanistan remained the hotbed of Pakistan-sponsored violence in 2019 too, as the country saw a series of terror blasts by the Taliban and Islamic State, the two prominent insurgent groups operating in the country. The wedding suicide bombing in Kabul by ISIS emerged as the deadliest terror attack in the country last year. A suicide bomber targeted an Afghan wedding, killing 92 people who belong to the country's minority Shiite Hazara community. The Islamic State of Iraq and the Levant group operating locally in Afghanistan as ISIS of Khorasan province claimed responsibility for the attack by issuing a statement on an ISIS-linked website. The group confirmed that a Pakistani Islamic State fighter targeted this large Shiite gathering in Kabul. It is pertinent to mention here that many countries in South Asia have seen an increase in terrorist activities from Islamic State of Iraq and the Levant, Daesh and its affiliates in the past few years.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We'll be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@anin.com. This is Shreya Savijay signing off on the behalf of entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.
Watching TAG TV.